Hello and welcome to this video tutorial. Today we will learn how to code message boxes or modal windows that will pop up when the user clicks a link on a web page. The modals will adapt to any screen size and always stay centered vertically as well as horizontally. Furthermore, we will code this using just plain HTML5 native technology. And you will find out that it's very easy now to code something like this without having to rely on frameworks like Bootstrap, jQuery, etc. As you can see, the modals can contain all sorts of HTML content and can even be modified to create something like this image lightbox here. Let's start by creating an index.html file. You might want to notice the viewport meta tag in the head section, which you should always include to prevent the default downscaling on mobile devices. I'm just adding some dummy content and pasting in some paragraphs here. I'm also creating a set of style tags in the head section of the document. Normally I would recommend that you use an external style sheet, but for the purpose of a better overview in this tutorial, I will embed the styles directly into the head section. I'm using the wildcard selector to reset the margin and padding for all elements in the document, and I'm also assigning a box sizing property to all the elements with the value border box. In the HTML markup, you can see that I have nested all the paragraphs in a div element with the class name page. This element I will just center on the page by giving it a max width and an automatic left and right margin. Okay, now we have created something that resembles a web page, and we can start to create the elements for the modal window itself. We will need a semi-transparent overlay screen, and for that we will use a div element, and I will give it the class name overlay outer and an ID with the same value. This div element will also serve as a container for all the other elements that we're going to need. In order to easily center the modal window, we will nest another div element inside the outer div with the class name and ID overlay inner. The box or frame for the window itself will also be a div element, once again with the class name and an ID with the value overlay content for both attributes. Finally, we will need two elements inside the modal window, a paragraph element, which I will give the class name modal string, and a button element that the user can press to close the window. The button element will have the class name and the ID closeBTN. The inner HTML of the button element will just be a small X, which is sort of the universal symbol for closing a window. But it might not be the most semantic labeling, so I will also add a title attribute with the value close window. That way there will be some sort of indication of what the button actually does. Let me just quickly add an ID to this element as well. And now we can see all the elements in the browser, but they are way down in the corner. It doesn't actually look like an overlay screen at all, so we will have to adjust the CSS a bit. So first we'll define some rules for the outer overlay element. Eventually we will set this element's display property to be none, but for now we will set the display property of the element to table, which will be sort of the active state. We will also give it a fixed position and a top and left value of 0. For the semi-transparent background effect, we will use RGBA values. The red, green and blue value will just be 256, that will give us a white color, and the value for the alpha channel will be 0.8. To have the overlay cover the entire viewport, we will give it a width and a height of 100%. Yes, and now we can see the nice overlay effect in the browser, but we will need the content centered, so let's add some style rules for the overlay inner div. We will set this element's display property to be table cell. That way we can align it vertically centered on the screen. To align the content horizontally, we will just add a text align property with the value center. And now we can see that we have the elements nicely centered on the screen. The element that we named overlay content will be sort of the window or the box around the modal content. So we will give it a light gray background color. But we can see that this element spans the entire viewport, and that is due to the nature of block elements. So if we just change the display property to display inline block, then we will have the element's width adapt to the content. To have the window stand out a bit more, we can give it a box shadow. The first two values will be the offset for the shadow, the next value will be the blur amount, and the last value is the color of the shadow. And I think we should make the shadow a bit darker. And we should also give the window a little bit of padding. I will give it a value of 1 relative m. Okay, that looks good. But I would like to have the close button positioned at the top right of the window. In order to move the button around, we'll need its parent element, the window itself, to have a relative position. That way we can give the button an absolute position and have its top and right properties be relative to the parent element. And I will give both properties a value of minus 10 pixels. That way the button will be just outside the window. And now I will just add some cosmetic brush up. I'll give it a bit of padding and a dark background and a light color. I will also remove the default border. And in order to have the button look a little more square, I think we need more padding left and right than we do top button. So let's just say 5 top button and 8 left and right. And that looks beautiful. A final nice detail could be to give the button's cursor property a value of pointer. That way the arrow will change to a pointer when the user hovers over the button. Okay, now we have done all the styling that we need, so I will hide the entire overlay container by changing the display value to none, because we would only want this element to be visible if the user chooses to open it, of course. And let's actually start to create some modal links. For now I'm just gonna use a hashtag for the href. Later on I will use the href attribute to point directly to the content for the modal window. But to get everything up and running quickly, I will just start by using a data attribute. And the value of this attribute will be the actual content that will pop up in the window. This is not a very semantic solution, but it will work fine for testing. I'm just copying and pasting the link a few random places in the document and changing the content a bit. But all the links should have the same class name, modal-link, because in a minute we'll be making a script that will make sure that all links with this particular class name will be open in the modal window. And I can't resist adjusting the margins of the paragraphs a bit, but that has nothing to do with the subject here, just aesthetic preferences. And now, finally, we're getting to the fun part, because we are going to code the script now. Don't be scared, this is going to be very simple, and you don't need any external dependencies, libraries, plugins, or anything like that. You will, however, need a set of script tags right here before the closing body tag. As you can see, I'm just laying out a plan here for the script. We need to create some variables that will contain references to the elements in the document. And we need to attach click events to these elements. And then we want to create some handler functions for the click events. To keep things nice and tidy, we could encapsulate all our good intentions in a function. Let's call the function pageLoad. When do we want to call this function? Well, of course, when the page has loaded, and we can do that by adding an event listener to the window object. The event listener takes two parameters. The first one is the event to listen for, which will be the load event, and the second parameter is the function that should be called. And let's actually check if the function is being called by logging a string in the console. And as we can see in the browser's console, everything is working fine. Now let's remove the console log line again and start to code the real function. First we will declare some variables which will be references to the elements in the document. The variable overlay outer is a reference to the entire overlay element, and we're getting that with document get element by ID. I'm also creating a variable called modal string It will be a reference to the paragraph element inside the modal window, which will actually contain the dynamic content. The next variable I will create is a reference to the button that closes the window. I will call that variable close overlay, and we'll also target that element by its ID. We will also need a reference to all the modal links, but we won't want to have to give each link an individual identifier. We want the script to work no matter how many links we have in the document. To do that, we can use document query selector all. This selector works like CSS selectors, so you have to add a dot before the class name. It will return a list of elements, and we will store that in a variable called modal links. And in order to attach click events to all the links, we can simply loop through the list with a for loop. A for loop is created by typing for and then a couple of parentheses with conditions for the loop. It should contain a local variable called I with an initial value of 0. Then we're going to specify that as long as I is less than the length of the list, then the loop should run. Lastly, we're going to increase the value of I with 1 by typing I++. At the moment, we have two links with the modal links class, so any code that I run here in the body of the for loop will run twice. As you can see, I'm just testing it by console logging a string. And when I run it in the browser, you can see in this little indicator here in the console that the string is being printed twice. So this should work no matter how many modal links we have in the document. Let me just add one more. And now you can see that the little indicator in the console changes to 3, showing us that the string is being printed 3 times. Now I've deleted the console log line, and instead I'm adding a click event listener to each modal link. Remember, the I that I use in the square brackets represent the current element in the list. Under click, I will run a handler function that we haven't created yet, and I will call it open modal. The last boolean value here in the event listener isn't something you should worry about. But let's go ahead and create the handler function. First of all, we would like to remove the default behavior of a link. If I press a link, you can see in the address bar that it navigates to the href location, this little hashtag here that we specified, and we would like to remove that. We're going to do that by passing the click event itself, the event object, to the function by typing event in the parameters, and then we can call a built-in function called preventDefault on the object. And now the default behavior of the link is removed, so it no longer navigates to the href location. And now we need to figure out how to get the actual value of the data attribute of every link. By using the this keyword, we can reference the link that was actually clicked when the handler function was called. And then we can use the getAttribute function and simply specify that we would like to get the value from the data modal attribute. Now I'm just console logging this value, and we can see that every time I press a link, we get this string that is stored in the data attribute of each individual modal link. But since it's not very likely that the user will have the console open in the browser, we would much rather have the string displayed in the overlay screen that we have made for the purpose. So instead, I'm going to assign the returned value of the getAttribute method to the inner HTML of the element that we called modal string. Remember, that was the most inner element of the whole modal window. Yeah, but we get an error here saying that the modal string element is actually null, and that is because I forgot to give the element an ID in the document. Remember, we were using getElementById for the modal string. Okay, now the error is gone, but we still don't see the pop-up window. And that is because, as you will remember, we set its display property to none in the CSS. So in the function here, we will change the style.display property of the overlay outer element and set its value to table, so that this element will now be visible when the handler function for the click is running. So we go back to the browser and refresh the page, and now we can see that the data attribute of the link is being printed in the modal window like it's supposed to. But the only way I can close the window is by refreshing the page. So we will need to attach a click event to the close button as well. So we go to the part of the script just below where we added the other click event listeners. But this time we don't have to loop through a lot of elements because the close button is unique and is already stored in a variable. So we will simply attach the click event listener to this variable, and the handle function we are going to call will be named closeModal. So let's navigate up to our handler functions and create this function. I'm just copying the two lines of code from the openModal function and simply changing the value of the inner HTML to nothing and setting the display property back to none. So let's try to test this, and there you have it, a nice modal function that works with native browser technology, no frameworks, no extra libraries whatsoever. Everything scales nicely and looks good at all resolutions. Now, using the data attribute to store content can have its use cases, but in most cases you would like screen readers and search engines to somehow connect the links with the content. So we will now try to improve this by having a real link destination and use the href attribute rather than the data attribute. We will store all the content for the modal windows in a hidden div on the page. I will give it a class name modal messages and make sure that it is hidden by giving it a style attribute with the display property set to none. Inside this hidden container element, we will store each individual link destination for the modals, and each link destination will be nested in a span tag with a unique ID that we can link to from the modal link. The next step is simply to have the href of each modal link point to the ID of the corresponding span element in the hidden container. I have only created two span elements, so this last modal link will just open the first message again. And while I'm at it, I will also delete the data attributes of the modal links because we don't need those anymore. Now we need to figure out how to get the string data from the element that the link points to. Remember, we were using the get attribute method to get the contents of the data attribute, but if I do the same for the href, I will only get the value of this attribute rather than the content of the link destination. But this value is still useful because I can supply it as an argument for the document's query selector method. This method returns the first element in the document that matches the query, and you can see now in the browser that we're actually getting the right element, but we're getting the entire object rather than just the string. So we need to specify that we want the inner HTML of the selected element, and we do that with a dot inner HTML. Yes, so now everything is working fantastic, and the real beauty of this is that unlike traditional alert boxes, the content of the modal windows could be all sorts of HTML content. I'm just trying to demonstrate this by formatting the content of the first span tag here. You could even use this to open images if you nest an image element in your span tag. However, I should warn you that many images would slow the rendering of the page down as these images get loaded while the page is loading. For larger image galleries, you would probably want to be using AJAX so that a request for the image is only made the minute the user clicks on the link. But that's a whole different topic. Right now, I want to thank you for watching the video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please give it a like and maybe even share the video or subscribe to my channel. Thank you so much for watching.